In this video, we're looking at a capacitor that's constructed very much like capacitors are in real life. We have two thin strips of foil separated by a thin strip of dielectric paper. And in fact, we would need a second strip of dielectric paper to go above or below the strips you see in the diagram so that when we roll this thing up into a cylinder, it wouldn't short out. So a lot of capacitors are actually made this way. We roll this into a tight cylinder like we see on the right. And this is actually why a lot of capacitors are cylindrical in appearance. So let's check out the numbers. We have a width for these strips of 1.5 centimeters, and I'm going to write that in terms of meters right now. That's 0.015 meters. We're given that the dielectric constant for this piece of paper is 1.9. The length of the foil strips is 55 meters long. And in part A, we want to get the capacitance of this capacitor. And when a dielectric constant is present, capacitance is given by kappa, that's the dielectric constant, times epsilon zero, that's the permittivity of free space, times the area of each plate divided by the distance between the plates. So we already know that kappa is 1.9. I haven't mentioned the number for the permittivity of free space though. That's 8.85 times 10 to the negative 12th farads per meter. And all we have to do is plug in here, 1.9 for kappa and the permittivity of free space. And then the area is just length times width in the correct units, so 0.015 meters multiplied by 55 meters. And then we divide by the separation between these foil strips, which we were told up here in the problem is 0.08 millimeters for the thickness of that paper. So we shift the decimal place three times to get that in terms of meters. All right, when we run the numbers on this, we get 1.73 times 10 to the negative 7 farads. And typically capacitors would be labeled in picofarads or microfarads, but nanofarads is not very typical. So I'm going to express this in terms of microfarads. So I shift the decimal place one to the left, tack on a factor of 10 to the scientific notation, that gives me 10 to the negative 6 or microfarads, and I have 0.173 microfarads. In part B, we want to get the charge on this capacitor if we hook it up to a 6 volt battery. So this goes back to the basic definition of capacitance. It's the charge per volt. And all we have to do is solve that for charge. It's capacitance times potential difference or voltage. So I take my 0.173 microfarads, multiply by 6.0 volts. And when I run the numbers on this and round to 3 sig figs, I get 1.04 microcoulombs. So notice that that micro was just tagging along in the calculation. It means 10 to the negative 6th. There's nothing wrong with just multiplying these numbers together and then remembering we have a factor of 10 to the negative 6 tagging along, and I can write my answer as microcoulombs. Finally, I want to get the energy stored in the capacitor when it's hooked up to this battery. And I normally write this as E cap, energy in a capacitor. And the basic formula for this is 1/2 CV squared. And we happen to have the capacitance and the voltage. Again, I'm going to work in units of microfarads here. So I have 0.173 microfarads. And then my 6 volts is squared. And this gives me 3.11. And there's a factor of 10 to the negative 6 hanging out because of that micro. So I get micro-Joules. And that's it. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.